Un'antologia trilingue di Barbara realizzata con Curtis D. Smith si intitola Tra il cielo e la terra, Between Heaven and Earth, poesie in cinese classico, italiano e inglese, del 2017. I suoi libri più recenti sono due volumi di arte, Gattizie del 2018 con Luciano Ragozzino e Voices from the Northerner del 2020. Barbara Carle è docente di italianistica alla California State University di Sacramento. Her presentation today is in English and it's titled Gained in Translation, Three Poems Read and Commented by a Poet, Translator and Italianist. Please welcome me in join me in welcoming Barbara Carle.
Grazie, grazie mille della gentilissima presentazione. Andiamo dritto al sodo. This is going to be in English, with of course poems also in Italiano. My experimentations between Italian and English poetry stem from my own translation practice, which I have exercised for around 30 years now. One of these experimentations consists of founding my current creative writing on the intersection between languages, not only between English and Italian, but also involving French, my maternal language. In this presentation, I will also briefly point out one experimental aspect of my new collection of poetry, the interplay between the poems, the titles, and the table of contents. In my essay titled On Translating from Antoine Berman to Antonia Pozzi, which was reprinted twice in 2000 and 2004, I formulated my first theoretical and practical considerations on this question. Remembering Martin Luther's translation of the Bible in the 16th century is an act which elevated much denigrated art, as well as seminal essays by Benjamin, Antoine Berman, Umberto Eco, Octavio Paz, Borges, and Lawrence Venuti's translation reader, among others, we can make a few observations. Most translation theories distinguish between the types and functions of different forms of translation. I agree with Octavio Paz when he writes that all translation is literary, and I note that his essay is not in Lawrence Venuti's translation reader. In fact, Paz is distinguishing the literary from the literal. Word-to-word rendering is not translation. If we use Google Translate for the following phrase such as ci metto una pietra sopra, we get I put a stone on it. And we know that this really means to turn the page, stop thinking about something, to move on. Such renderings might help us understand the original words, but they are not sufficient for the comprehension of an entire phrase. Meaning is produced in the context of syntax and textual layout. It is not based strictly on these individual units, which are words. There are always several ways to render sentences from one language to the other. There is always a better way, even in medical, legal, or scientific translations. They occur in language, which means literary operations are necessary for all forms of translation. And I will quote briefly from Octavio Paz's essay. I do not mean to imply that literal translation is impossible. What I am saying is that it is not translation. All translations utilize the two modes of expression to which, according to Roman Jakobson, all literary procedures are reduced, metonym and metaphor. The original text never reappears in the new language, this would be impossible, yet it is ever present because the translation, without saying it, expresses it constantly or converts it into a verbal object that, although different, reproduces it, metonym or metaphor. End of quotation. We live in an age in which the translation process is perceived as a pure transaction, with emphasis fixed on the transfer of given content through so-called neutral and different linguistic means, ultimately to convey the same. Nevertheless, the common romantic myth of the untranslatability of poetry still persists. It assumes translation into another language somehow renders the original impure. The cliché lost in translation concludes that as soon as a poem travels to another language, it is by some means degraded. There is a subcurrent of xenophobia in this commonplace idea. It also assumes, as Jorge Luis Borges pointed out, and I quote, that every recombination of elements is necessarily inferior to the original form. The concept of the definitive text corresponds only to religion or exhaustion, end of quote. As a matter of fact, it is true that certain texts are untranslatable. I am thinking of dialect poetry, such as that of Lino Angiuli, in his forthcoming book of poetry titled Green Poems, which I translated. He uses phrases and words from the Apulian dialect. Since dialect is strictly connected to the region where it is spoken, it loses meaning once it is transported. And Julie and I decided to leave words in the original, and not to go into all the words, for example, one everyone probably knows, such as trullo, and insert a note, because not all English-speaking readers might know what a trullo is. In this way, a new word could enter the English language. We did the same for Latin phrases and other such expressions, of which there are many in his poems. And we concluded that the benefits of translation outweighed the shortcomings. Luckily, Anjuli understands that translation is transformation. In the wake of these observations, if we let go of a canonical and sacralizing concept of literature in favor of a transformational process of writing or écriture, we can rid ourselves of a valorization system between source and target, which underlies most translation theories. On the contrary, translation may become a tool to renew not only the target language, but the source language as well, is in a reciprocal process working two ways. In fact, my poems continuously move from one language to the other in a dialectical fashion. Deriving from translation, my creative method became clear to me when I rewrote in both languages my long narrative poem, Voices of the Northerner, which is about an 1860 shipwreck off the lost coast of California. The Italian poem version ended up being written in endecasillabi, the very long, flexible 11-syllable line used by Dante and still present today in contemporary poetry. The Italian brought out the inconsistencies and flaws of my English, triggering a thorough rewriting of each. This recreating between languages helped me reread my own work. When we write and revise our own texts, we tend to read what we meant to write, not what we actually wrote. Our initial intention interferes with our capacity of reading our own text as though it were someone else's. One of my favorite writers, Italo Calvino, ironically refers to the cloud many writers have in their head when they try to reread their own work, and I quote, "Ci sono tanti, anche tra gli scrittori, che non sono capaci di leggersi, né mentre scrivono, né dopo. Vedono sul foglio una nuvoletta coi loro pensieri dentro, non le parole scritte." End of quote. This interlinguistic process became my main modus operandi of drafting and revising texts. Most representative of this method is the new edition of my bilingual book, Touching What Remains, Toccare Quello Che Resta. The first version was published in 2009, and now, 11 years later, the second edition is at press. Since the revision process occurred between language, with each revision engendering a new version in the other language, it was a drawn-out process. I will give you some short examples. And now, let's make sure the screen sharing is working. Is that good? See? The first two poems, then, are from the first edition. And you can remark that they are short. Okay, they're short poems, English 5 lines, the Italian 6 lines. The poems are inspired by objects, but not necessarily determined by them. Reading is often a projection of what the reader expects to find in the text. And the title helps to reinforce this identification and projection onto the text. Therefore, removing the title could help provoke a reader response that will not reduce the text to a pure illustration of the title. The idea is to create a sort of enigma that could prolong reading discovery. The titles of each poem may be found at the end in the table of contents. So a few poems have acrostics that reveal the title. Okay, some of them, not all of them. So this is from the first version, which I'll briefly read, these two versions. Bounces toward the sky, although drawn to the ground. Leans around hills and mounds. Loves to please by achieving perfect revolutions. Pioniera del cielo, anche se la terra la trae, leale alle forme telluriche, leggera ogni sua mossa circolare. Ama conquistare con ogni sua perfetta rivoluzione. The second two poems are from the 2021 edition. As you can see, these versions are even shorter. The English 4 lines, the Italian 5. In this case, the difference is caused by the acrostic in each language, which hopefully you can see and guess what it is. Each poem is conditioned by the nature of its language, as Edward Sapir so beautifully reminds us, and I quote him, "Languages are invisible garments that drape themselves about our spirit and give it a predetermined form to all, and give a predetermined form to all its symbolic expression." Therefore, in this case, end of quote, each version bounces from the other in a symmetrical yet dynamic manner. And I'll briefly read these two rewritings. Bounces toward the sky, although drawn to the ground, leans around hills and mounds, loves to achieve revolution. Piroetta verso il cielo, anella la terra, lambisce le colline, lega i campi, ama la rivoluzione. Before moving on, I would like to say a few words about the question of authors commenting their own texts. Although numerous writers have done so, such as Lorenzo de' Medici, Dante, and Umberto Saba, to name a few, nevertheless, they are not the most authoritative. Indeed, one of my literary mentors, French poet and theorist Paul Valéry, disciple of Mallarmé, explains it best, saying that there is no authority of the author once the text is published. What the writer wanted to say no longer counts. What he wrote determines the text's fate, which belongs to all readers. All of this to say that my commentary only points out the process behind my own compositions. And before I comment my own poems, I'd like to comment Valerio Magrelli, who also wrote a poem on his work of translator in a well-known piece called L'Imballatore. Okay, so I want to share this. This is from Esercizi di Tittologia. And I chose it since I couldn't find many poems on translation. So Magrelli's text is preceded by an epigraph, a quotation from another great writer and translator, Vladimir Nabokov, which is, I'll read to you, which I didn't put it here. Cos'è la traduzione? Su un vassoio la testa pallida e fiammante d'un poeta. And we'll read this one and then move on to my own text. L'imballatore. L'imballatore chino che mi svuota la stanza fa il mio stesso lavoro. Anch'io faccio cambiare casa alle parole che non sono mie, e metto mano a ciò che non conosco senza capire cosa sto spostando. Sto spostando me stesso, traducendo il passato in un presente che viaggia sigillato, racchiuso dentro pagine e dentro casse con la scritta fragile, di cui ignoro l'interno. E questo il futuro, la spola, il traslato, il tempo manovale e citeriore, trasferimento e troppo, la ditta di trasloco. Critics have commented on this poem, discussing the emotional and mental reaction of the translator, who must handle fragile, intricate, and complex objects that are frequently polysemic. He must transport them from one place to another, but also from one time to another. Much has been written on the cultural appropriation, on cultural appropriation in translation, less on temporal colonization of the past by the present. Magrelli's poem shows that he is aware of this other complicating issue in translation and literary studies. Certainly, this admirable poem treats the same theme as my own text. The difference lies in the fact that Magrelli writes in Italian, only comparing the art of the mover to that of the translator or translocator. While my own poems, as I've already said, were drafted between Italian and English back and forth, in a way, they may be considered a sort of compendium of my years of work as poet, translator, and Italianist in one place, which is why they're experimental. They're inspired by uniquely Italian form, the sonnet, which was invented, as we all know, in the court of Federico II, the Holy Roman Emperor, but clearly shaped by this interlinguistic process of rewriting. Although the poems address the same topic, translation, they are distinct in each language. And here I'm going to go into some technical questions briefly. In English, words generally, okay, not exclusively, of course, are generally shorter with respect to Italian. So if you're trying to write metrically, I'm speaking of 10, 11 syllable lines, more words fit into a poetic line of 10 or 11 syllables. In Italian, since words are generally longer, fewer words fit into the traditional endecasillabo. If one begins in English and then goes to Italian, one ends up removing all the peripheral embellishments and focusing on the essential. On the contrary, if one begins in Italian and then goes to English, one has to draw out the line to fit into the 10 or 11 spaces. And this aspect may be clearly viewed in the first lines of the two poems, my two poems on translation. Okay, so the Italian has fewer words than the English, but this is not a perfect pattern, okay? But it's, let's say, frequent. There are more words in the English than in the Italian, generally speaking. Yet in this case, the English version of my poem is slightly longer than the Italian version, okay? The English version has 16 lines, whereas the Italian has 14 lines. This could also be related to the intrinsic nature of each language. Italian, being the descendant of Latin, is more compact. Although words may be longer, fewer words are required to express concepts. We can leave out subject pronouns required in English. Often a verb tense in Italian expresses a temporal clause without any prepositions, and so forth. The Italian version uses endecasyllables and internal rhyme, while the English uses different types of rhyme and assonance, including end rhyme and alternating rhyme. The English verb, the English poem, ends, as you'll see, with the word start, suggesting the act of writing and rewriting, while the Italian ends with the word varco, suggesting opening or breakthrough. Each version expresses a parallel concept of translation as rewriting and transformation. Each is the translation, is the transformation of the other, and the translation as well, both. So I will conclude by reading these two poems, which are forthcoming in the Italian Poetry Review a bit later this year. So this is the first one, La Traduzione. In bilico tra due zone esisto. Traduco la morte in vita e la vita in morte. Sospesa sull'arco instabile di Hermes, dove insisto nel trasporto, resisto levando le vele d'aria, traghetto ponti rigenerabili, collego continenti, epoche, lingue, lemmi antichi con mille echi e quelli appena sbarcati senza permessi. Sono genitrice di connessioni, di reincarnazioni acrobatiche, restituisco senso all'incompreso, chiudo porte per aprire mondi, sono la curva sinuosa del varco. And this is the English version. My tranche lately runs among two ridges, where I exist between opposing peaks, since my task is to translate death into life and life into death, suspended on the bridge of Hermès, as I continue to seek yet another epiphany of flight. I ferry nascent parallels to beaches, connect continents, echoes of speeches, antique words living with a thousand reaches, and those just arrived that no one teaches. I am a creator of reflections and acrobatic reincarnations. I restore meaning to incomprehension, renewing literature with my art. I close doors to open up new worlds. I am the curving arch of each fresh start. Grazie, thank you for listening to this experiment.
Grazie mille. Thank you so much for this inspiring presentation. All right, let's move on to our next speaker and we hold our questions for later.
Excuse me, Viola, I'm so sorry to interrupt. Do the other presenters wish for their presentations to be recorded or should we end the recording?
I have no problem.